Gerrymandering. It's a very hot topic, and one that is extremely topical because congressional districts are being redrawn this year. If you're out of the loop, that's okay, I'll fill you in. Gerrymandering is when a state legislature manipulates boundaries of an electoral constituency to favor one party or class. Before I show you real-world examples, here are some I've created myself. This is Tomato Town, population 20. Tomato Town's residents are split 50-50, but their House representatives are a majority blue. In theory, the House delegation should be split 50-50 like this, with four districts in each color having two representatives. But the blue team redrew the lines unfairly, so now the blue team has three representatives and the red team has one. A town doesn't have to be split 50-50 in order for this to happen, though. This is Potato Land. The blue team makes up 60% of land, while the red team makes up 40% of Potato Land. In Potato Land, though, a house district is 5 houses instead of Tomato Town's 4 houses per district. Potato Land had fair districts. The blue team controlled one district, absolutely, as well as two districts that could be considered competitive but were also blue. The red team controlled one district that could also be considered competitive. The blue team is the majority, so it's expected that naturally they will have an advantage in competitive districts. Then, one midterm, the blue team just didn't show up to vote, so the red team won control of the state legislature. The red team is the minority, but they will now draw the district lines, and here's what they did. They packed blue into one singular district, then created three other districts that could be considered competitive, but red now controls two of those. This is quite the change. Before this change, 60% of the population controlled 75% of the districts. While this overrepresented the blue a bit, they were the majority, and it's about as close to fair as you can get with four districts. These new lines that the red team has drawn has now underrepresented the blue team. Despite making up 40% of the population, they now control 50% of the districts. Congressional lines last for 10 years, so for the next 5 House elections, the red team will be overrepresented despite the majority of citizens being part of the blue team. Let's look at some real-life examples. These can get really bad. This is Texas's 2nd congressional district, which Dan Crenshaw currently represents. It reaches down into Houston, then goes into the suburbs like a boa constrictor. When we pull up our partisan dot map, we can see that this district is part of a cracking effort. It takes part of the city's Democratic vote and then drowns it out with the Republican suburbs. This is what used to be Florida's 5th congressional district before the Florida Supreme Court threw it out. This is how the Washington Post described the district. It runs from near Jacksonville in the north, hooks east for a few miles, then west for a few miles, narrows to the width of the interstate for a while, cuts west all the way over to Gainesville, then swivels back east and southeast, finally arriving in Orlando in a distance of about 140 miles, sweeping in black neighborhoods along the way in order to create a minority-majority district. Federal judge said that it was visually not compact, bizarrely shaped, and defying traditional political boundaries with finger-like extensions, narrow and bizarrely shaped tentacles, and hook-like shapes. And he wasn't wrong. Here's the racial dot map. It quite literally just grabs black communities to put into the district. This is Illinois' 4th congressional district, which is currently represented by Chewy Garcia. It's nicknamed Earmuffs because it looks like a pair of earmuffs. This is a racial gerrymander. However, this is actually an example of good district drawing. The 4th congressional district was drawn to give Latinos a chance to elect someone of their choosing, while also not diluting the interests of African American communities. It's the only majority Latino district in the Midwest. This is what used to be North Carolina's 12th congressional district. This is another example of a racial gerrymander and a really bad use of it. This is a race dot map. Green dots represent black residents, while blue dots represent white residents. As you can see, this narrow line cuts through entire cities and half the state to put black residents into one district. Of course, this also matches up with Democratic votes. So why is NC-12 bad racial gerrymandering, while IL-4 is good racial gerrymandering? There are several reasons why, but I'll focus on two of them. The first reason as to why is because of distance. Greensboro and Charlotte, North Carolina, are 100 miles away from each other. That's longer than the distance between Chicago and Milwaukee, and New York and Philly. Ask any resident of those four cities do they think they should share a representative. Personally, I wouldn't, but if you're a Maskicist, go for it. While in Illinois, only 4 miles separate the two halves. The second reason has to do with the manner in which it originated. Every district around IL-4 is blue, and if IL-4 didn't exist in its current shape, the result of the district would not matter. IL-4's existence seeks to give a voice to the Latino community without drowning out the voice in nearby black communities. NC-12 did the opposite of this. NC-12 didn't seek to give a voice to the black community, it seeked to drown out its voice. With NC-12, North Carolina Republicans held 10 of the state's 13 congressional districts. When a federal court ordered the lines redrawn, they now only hold 8 of the state's 13 congressional districts. NC-12 was designed to create solidly white districts that vote Republican. You can see that on the racial dot map here, and how it cuts and weaves, collecting every black community along the way. Let's address the $400 million question. Does gerrymandering hurt our democracy? Obviously, it's never good when democracy is undermined by those with a partisan agenda. Gerrymandering is counter to the principle of one person, one vote. A great example of that is North Carolina's 2018 midterms. Here was the House of Representatives' popular vote. Republicans beat out the Democrats by 70,000 votes. But here the House seats won. Democrats only won 3 seats, while Republicans won 9 seats, despite Republicans only winning by 72,000 votes. Obviously, House seats aren't determined by a state's popular vote, but it should be close to or match the amount of seats won. This disparity is caused by North Carolina's gerrymandering. Gerrymandering hurts our democracy when districts aren't drawn fairly or aren't drawn to protect community interests but to benefit a partisan agenda. Does gerrymandering make us more divided? Well, there is evidence to suggest that those in very lopsided districts are more extreme in their views than their competitive district counterparts. However, there is a lot of evidence that gerrymandering isn't why we're so polarized. Democrats and Republicans were just as polarized before in Tomato Town and Potato Land when they had fair districts than they were after unfair districts were drawn. Our division doesn't stem from gerrymandering, however, it doesn't necessarily make it better. So are there any arguments in favor of gerrymandering? Yes. Supporters of gerrymandering say that it creates more representative districts. When you put all Republicans in a district and all Democrats in another district, both sides are happy with their representative. This is a convincing argument, but it falls short. It implies that the left and right are black and white, and that middle ground can't be found in communities. It also gives a serious two Americas vibe. Gerrymandering is 2021's political topic of the year, and hopefully you know more now than you did before.